Hi, subscriber base. Sorry I haven't been posting as often, but I have to prioritize my reputation as the Boo Radley of K-pop YouTube, which means my time is mainly devoted to 3-minute mac and cheese, staring at the ceiling, and making up philosophical debates with the friends I don't have. You understand how it is. I get that this video was basically asked for by no one at all, but I'm trying to do that thing where I talk about whatever I'm currently interested in and hoping I still have subscribers at the end of it. I hope you find it somewhat entertaining. Originally, this was going to be the first of many little video essays discussing some songs, eras, and concepts I find interesting or underappreciated, but the more I learned about it, the crazier it got. Story time. So it's late December, a few days after Red Velvet dropped Psycho, when I counted down my favorite K-pop songs of 2019. I mentioned in the video that the total list of songs I enjoyed that year was over 100 entries long, and I featured the top 20 as my favorites, with guest appearances from songs 21 through 27 as honorable mentions. But a bit farther down on that list is song 30, Wave by Limesoda. I might even rank it a bit higher now, as it really aged like fine wine, but after making that list, I went into a holiday coma and promptly forgot about it. Flash forward a few months later, and I made this video where I reimagined each Luna solo with thematically similar songs from my regular playlist, and as such, there's a section in the video dedicated to Trary. And for those of you who've seen the video, you may remember me saying this. I went and I got her choreography video as well because I didn't exactly know what I wanted for the line, "I was shotgun running away," but I knew it deserved something special. And then I played around with the shot of them all rippling out and I was like, yes! A funny thing happened behind the scenes in that video. While I was making Trary's edit, I noticed that this dancer looked very familiar. And then my brain remembered that we actually have 2 brain cells available for use, did that Jimmy Neutron thing, and I remembered, oh, of course, that's Jungmi from entry number 30. Apparently, Jungmi debuted in the group Limesoda. Good for her. And subsequently, she ends up in one of the weirdest K-pop side stories I've found in a little while. And yes, Limesoda did make an appearance on the Greek show Globetrotters. Hiram was wearing a Jurassic Park t-shirt. That was the thing that happened. So let's talk about Wave. I love this song. Wave is a quality example of delicious, low-budget K-pop. The song itself is clean 2016 pop, even as a 2019 release, but it really owns that and leans into the chromatic Californian vibe. It's got a nice surfer's undertone, which plays well with the title, although this music video has absolutely nothing to do with waves, literal or romantical. I adore Hyeram's voice. Her voice is buttery and tangy in all the right places, and it sounds the way orange juice tastes. She does this thing in the pre-chorus where she cinches her syllables into a beat and throws her voice into her nose. It helps the song feel higher quality and overall more impressive, like something JYP might have released a few years ago. The chorus is catchy, it's danceable, it's quintessentially K-pop. The hook had some moments of confusion after the song first came out, because it was hard to tell if the line was "make up your mind" or "back up your mind." Turns out it's neither. The line is apparently "back of your mind," like the back of your mind. Which I think out of all the options is by far the most confusing, but I still think it's a really solid earworm. Go give it a listen. Any road. The video is where things get interesting. This is where the budget rears its head. I have to admit, I absolutely love music videos like this, where the producers clearly have a vision for what they could do with an extra $1 million, but they just don't have the time or the money. I love seeing what artists do with limitations, and videos like these have that homemade sort of feeling to them, like something was filmed in an abandoned warehouse or in your friend's garage after school, and now you've got to add a ton of color filters and Premiere effects so no one knows that's secretly your mom's bathtub. There's something charming about it, and it makes me selfishly happy that they didn't have that extra $1 million, because I think the art team created something super endearing through working with what they have. Like, yeah, okay, HBO's Westworld is cinematic and high budget and fine, but have you seen the 70s movie where they shoot people to lively banjo music and red paint splatters everywhere? That's quality shit. I love the clothes, the hair, especially Jungmi's look. You guys know how I am about a well-placed hat. K-pop is afraid of hats, and I will not let one so good as this go by. It's angular to go with her high cheekbones, the dark, dark hair, and the slip rim. They even do her up in a bandana at one point, and I just love her long skater girl hair. Seungji has these really standout turquoise aqua hair tones. She's got the mesh, the knot tops. She's the dangerous, kind of confident girl. Kyeram wears the more go-go style in the black and white ensembles. She's that kind of bubbly princess type in this video. And it's a really nice mix of visual appeals. I love that each of their outfits could have just come from their own closets. It feels accidentally natural, and I love that the video keeps stumbling into these delightfully real moments. There are all these random after effects, like thunder in the beginning for no reason, weird petri dishes flying around, the members shooting actual lasers of death at the camera, and these graphics of exploding glass cubes, or maybe it's supposed to be ice, but you know, there they are, and they keep exploding into little destroyed pieces of cube. Someone on the graphics team was a Cheshire, I'm sure. These are such $2 touch-ups, and that's what makes this video so charming. In a similar vein, you see a lot of the same production elements in ANS's Boom Boom, which I see as the low-budget monochrome sister of Crush's concept. It's super endearing, and I think we always forget just how many artists are out there making things with the resources they can scrounge up. We see the tip of the iceberg, the successful groups with decent budgets and dependable sales, but I think it's exciting and sometimes even more interesting to take a look at groups under the waves, where you can see how different creative teams respond to their limits. I feel somewhat like that's become a style in and of itself, where you can see that a group and its producers were inspired by the polished music videos of bigger companies, so they set out to recreate the tropes with all the confidence of a sixth grader making a baking soda volcano after watching Discovery Channel. These videos always end up looking a little rougher around the edges and just a little odd. It's when life gives you lemons, but literally nothing other than lemons, so now you're just trying to make lemonade without cups or sugar or a juicer, and now there's lemon juice everywhere, and oh my god, it burns. I love these videos, they're delicious. But there's something about Wave that's just a little more bizarre than its financial siblings. Wave is just flat out strange. The framing is constantly wigging out. There are these sudden out-of-beat cuts that happen in the middle of unfinished camera movements. There are pans that clearly move around huge curvatures, but the zoom is so tight it feels like we're suddenly orbiting the members' earrings. The letterboxing jumps around with seemingly no pattern, and there are parts to the video where it's clearly manually stretched or digitally enlarged to get rid of the sides, which messes with the quality. It's basically 3 minutes of watching the render do the hokey pokey. There are these long extended gaps where no one is visibly singing or dancing, so they just nod or make hand gestures, shots where a different clip was clearly meant to go in place, and frankly, I dig it. Like I said, I adore that workshop feel, and the disorienting editing affair of Wave makes it extremely unique and entertaining. However, being entertaining doesn't really explain why an otherwise decently filmed video was edited so unusually. So I did a little digging, and it turns out when Wave was filmed, Limesoda had 4 members. Aside from Kyeram, Jungmi, and Seungji, Limesoda had a 4th member named Teeny, and I'm like, oh, okay, now I see her. She's got the bright red hair, she sticks out, she goes with the starkly colored long hair theme of the rest of them, she's at the front of the formation, she's in a lot of the shots. Except it's not this girl, it's this girl. The one with the short maroon hair and the blonde highlights. You know, the one who's dressed almost identically to the background dancers in the wide shots. About 2 weeks before Wave was released, Teeny left the group. If you're wondering why she left, that's a bit more convoluted. There's a lot of he said, she said about Limesoda and their company D-Maker, but here's a very bare bones rundown of the claims. Limesoda fandom, please don't kill me. D-Maker was at one point playing footsie under the dinner table with the company TNK, and they shared some trainees behind doors. Limesoda was originally Hyeram and Seungji, and there was this idea roughly to add members each comeback as the group went along. Limesoda planned to add new members Jimin, Teeny, and potentially Yeji, Jimin and Yeji being the trainees under TNK in this story. However, around spring of 2018, TNK and D-Maker apparently got into a really heavy marital fight and they broke up, so neither Jimin nor Yeji were part of the group. Yeji, on the other hand, eventually joined ANS under the stage name Jay. After All Eyes on Me, 2 more girls were added to Limesoda, with Jungmi going from dance instructor to the group's leader, and Teeny as Limesoda's first Chinese member. So finally, we get to Wave, which came out over a year after their last comeback and was supposed to have all four girls. However, before the comeback could drop, Teenie announced that she was leaving the group. Allegedly, there was some controversy surrounding whether Teenie was secretly in contact with a Chinese company and breached her contract in contacting them. There are three main claims to what happened. Number one, D-Maker flipped out and kicked her out. Number two, Teenie left of her own accord. And number three, the other members of Limesoda told the staff she was in contact with this other company, and then either claims one or two happened. Personally, I don't think any of these sound like the perfect, unnuanced truth. Many different perspectives have been brought up, such as how companies treat foreign idols, but also how the other girls don't even speak Chinese to begin with, so how would they know she was breaching her contract? And D-Maker is kind of tight-lipped about the group's management and history. After Teenie started taking interviews about what happened behind the scenes, Limesoda fans called her out for spreading lies about the other members, which developed into the obligatory apologize to Limesoda tag on Twitter. Again, I myself am not personally sure exactly who is right, who is wrong, who's telling the truth, and I probably never will be. So take this with all of the salt of your neighbor Karen's casserole. What really interests me is what happened next. Where Jimin and Yeji left before they could be in any part of the official promotions, Teenie actually made it into the Wave video. Basically, the group was about to have a comeback with 1/4 of their team missing. So get this, the editing team went back in and recropped the whole video to edit her out. And suddenly, everything about this video makes sense. There's a whole other friggin' girl in the video that the producers are trying to hide. The editors did all this weird reframing and snipping to make it look like Teenie was never even there. And for the most part, I think they succeeded. I didn't even notice her the first few times I saw it, but even though I couldn't point out Teenie, there's still snatches of her throughout the video, and her voice is still audible on some copies of the song. There are numerous silhouette shots of her left in, places where the editing makes it seem like some random dancer just forgot to get off camera, and parts where there's clearly a whole ass other human sitting next to Jungmi. The process left Wave with this extremely bizarre feeling where Teenie is basically haunting the video. It's just a bizarre video, and the fact that there's this strange behind-the-scenes story to it makes it stick out more to me. And I guess that makes sense. It's weird to realize there's another member just hiding in plain sight the whole time. Where before I felt the concept was chrome-colored retro girl crush, now I think the concept is hide Teenie. What a weird video. As for Limesoda, Hiram actually left the group recently, so right now I think it's just Seungji and Jungmi. I have no idea what's going to happen to the group either, or if they'll ever have another comeback, if they'll add new members, or if D-Maker is just going to wash their hands of the whole affair. But I kind of really want to see Jungmi make it in the industry because she keeps popping up into my K-pop life, so we'll check back in with her later. That was really it for the video. I just wanted to talk about this strange moment in K-pop history. I hope it was somewhat fun for you guys because I love talking about weird things like this. Okay, bye.